Building Green on BCTV is supported by BARDA.
Okay. Good morning. My name is Bill Vitale. This is Building Green. I'm your host. The program is aired live the second Tuesday of each month in this time slot. And you can also catch reruns each month on BCTV, as well as stream it on bctv.org, the YouTube channel, along with other programs. And I think I'm hoping this program gets a lot of viewership because we've got an interesting guest and an interesting topic. So the topic today sounds a little bit dense, is parabolic dish solar thermal power. Sounds like a PhD dissertation, but it's not. This is something in the real world, and my guest, Naoise Irwin, is going to tell you all about it. So welcome, Naoise.
Thank you. Good to be here.
Naoise is the co-founder and CEO of Solarflux Energy Technologies, a company that is in the production chain process. He'll tell us where they are in the timeline of producing technology to generate solar-generated thermal energy. Mm-hmm. So before we go to the topic, let's get a little bit of background from Naoise. So again, welcome. And why don't you just tell us a little bit about who you are, how you came to this.
So my name is Naoise Irwin. I'm the co-founder and CEO of Solarflux Energy Technologies. This is a company that was co-founded back in 2019 to commercialize a technology that had been quite long in development, what we're calling the Focus Parabolic Dish Concentrator. We'll talk about that in a second. My background, I'm originally from Ireland. I came to the United States in 2004 to go to business school in California and worked in technology finance for a little while and then in technology growth companies, software companies specifically. And ended up in Pennsylvania for personal reasons. I've always had a passion for solar energy going back a long time. And when I came across this technology through some circumstances and ended up partnering with the sort of technology leaders of this project to try to commercialize it. And that's kind of how the company got started originally.
So your background, you have strong background in business, and that's where you're bringing a good.
Yeah, example. Yeah. When I came across this technology, it was clear that it had been developed from an engineering point of view to a very quite extensive degree, but it seemed to me that what it really needed was more effective marketing and sales. And the more I learned about the technology, the more conviction I got that this had real potential, and I just felt like I was in a good position with my background and my interest in the technology to try to help get it to the market.
So just give us a little bit of a broad picture of Solarflux, what the company is. When it got started, how big it is.
Yeah, so we're sort of a developmental company in some ways. It was founded in 2019. Like I said, so I have two co-founders, John Fangman and Professor Sudhakar Netty. They are the developers of the technology of the parabolic dish concentrator. The origin of the technology goes back about 15 years. It was originally inspired by a vision to try to develop a clean energy solution for the billions of people around the world who live in, very energy poor conditions, people who live in rural parts of India, rural parts of Africa, where they don't have ready access to affordable fuels and are relying on harvesting local wood, biomass to burn for basic needs like cooking and boiling water. There's a lot of problems with this in terms of deforestation and people burning those fuels in their houses, inhaling the fumes, getting, you know, having health consequences from that. So that was the original idea, was to try to develop a technology to help meet their needs, a sort of remote municipal power solution. Eventually, it was decided or realized that to realize this vision, it would have to be commercialized, and and also that there was a significant potential market for this, and we can talk about that in a couple of seconds.
So, one other question: how did you end up in Berks County?
I married someone from Berks County.
Oh, I see.
That's how I ended up here. My partner.
Me too.
Yeah, it's a common story, I think. but it's a great location for what we're doing, I believe. There happen to be a lot of very talented engineers in this region. We've got some great universities in the greater region. Professor Nettie is a professor emeritus at Lehigh University. And we also have our chief technology officer has lived in Berks County for a long time and formerly worked at AT&T Bell Labs, which had a big operation here back in the day. And there's a lot of very talented and very capable engineers in this region who are very important to us being able to develop the technology that we're working on. So I think there's a lot of benefits to actually being here. It may be maybe a little underappreciated, but I've come to realize that as the more I've worked on this.
Okay, that's great. Yeah, I agree. And I think that's true. I think there's a lot more, especially in the engineering field, the different companies that have been here over the decades, and there's a deep history.
Yes.
We can come back to some other related questions, but let's talk about the technology itself. In general and then more specifically, what it is you're producing.
I could switch. I have a few slides I could share just to talk about the general problem we're trying to solve and then the technology itself. Hopefully you can see my screen.
Yeah, I think we're okay.
Okay. So just to jump in here. So I kind of alluded to this when I was talking earlier. So the mission of the company is to facilitate equitable access to clean energy and water for all. That was the original mission when the technology was developed. And the idea is we want to make a very easy to manufacture, easy to maintain, and very cost-effective sustainable energy solution available to people all over the world. Something that could be manufactured in places like India, in Africa, with the technological capacity that they have in those regions. So this does not require advanced semiconductor manufacturing equipment, for example. It can be manufactured with relatively simple production methods. So that's our kind of general mission. The problem we're trying to solve, or the problem we're trying to address, is the vast and growing need for sustainable thermal energy. And just to talk a bit more about that, this chart shows the projections for overall global energy consumption from today going out 30 years. And basically what we're projecting, or what the EIA, Energy Information Administration, is projecting, is about a 50% growth in overall energy consumption in the next 30 years. And that's driven by population growth and increasing energy consumption per capita. So that's a big challenge, because we're already facing some issues with the amount of energy consumption that we're undertaking today. So there's a massive growing need for energy, and particularly sustainable energy. And by the way, you'll notice that the most disproportionately fast growing portion of the energy footprint is renewable energy. And that's the segment that we're targeting here. Another point that is really important, and I think a lot of people don't fully realize, is about half of that energy footprint is consumed as heat. So only about half is electricity, and the other half is heat. There are sustainable energy technologies that are available to generate electricity, photovoltaic panels, wind power. However, the heat footprint really has not been addressed until now, particularly effectively. Now, if we break down the heat footprint a little more, about half of the heat footprint is actually for industrial applications. So that's things like, food processing, where you're cooking or sterilizing foods. In the dairy industry, you're pasteurizing milk. And there's many other examples of industrial process heat applications. Those all require direct heat. Usually people are burning natural gas or fuel oil to generate that heat. And that produces carbon emissions, obviously. And the other huge portion of thermal energy consumption is building space and water heating. So that's another massive sort of energy use. So each of these account for almost a quarter of global energy consumption individually. So what are the possible solutions that are available to try to meet, to deliver sustainable heat so that we can address this portion of the energy footprint and lower our emissions at the same time? So here, these are kind of like the four. If you look at solar, which is one of the big, obviously, opportunities for sustainable heat, these are the four main technologies that are out there for concentrated solar power. So you've got parabolic trough in the top left. You've got linear Fresnel in the bottom left, power tower in the bottom right, and then parabolic dish in the top right. So parabolic trough and power tower are the two most widely popularized or adopted forms of concentrated solar power. Parabolic trough, it's sort of like a long row of reflective mirrors that are curved, and they track the sun from east to west as it arcs through the sky, and they focus all the light on these kind of this long pipe in the middle, that's the receiver. And that creates very high temperatures, it heats a fluid, and then that's used for generating electricity. The linear Fresnel is very similar, except you've got kind of like a series of mini troughs. You've got a bunch of individual mirrors, and each mirror tracks the sun, and it focuses onto that central point. And then the power towers are these huge towers with vast fields of mirrors surrounding them, and they reflect the sun onto the tower and generate extremely high temperatures and generate electricity. And then the parabolic dish is this kind of curved dish format, and the dish tracks the sun on two axes, so it's always perfectly aligned with the sun, and then it focuses the light onto the receiver, and very much like the parabolic trough, heats a temperature flowing through the receiver to a very high degree. So the most efficient of all of these, and this is widely accepted, is and sort of axiomatic really, is the parabolic dish, and the reason is because it is always tracking the sun, and it is always perfectly aligned with the sun, and the full dish gets exposed to the sun. So you'll get, in the 70% overall efficiency range for parabolic dish on a peak and on an average basis. Parabolic trough is more like about 55% efficient. Linear Fresnel is, I think, in the 30% range. And power tower is in the 40 to 45% range in terms of overall efficiency. So the dish is definitely the most efficient. There's been a perception historically that the parabolic dish is a little bit complicated because, you have to make this curved dish structure that has this compound shape, and then it's got a two-axis tracking mechanism as well. So there's this perception that's complicated. So what's the best solution? Well, our view is that the parabolic dish is the winner in this whole game, at least for certain solutions. And now let's just talk about that really quick. So our solution, our version of the dish is, we believe, the first truly productized parabolic dish. It's the first modern parabolic dish, which again is the most efficient concentrated solar power technology. So here's a photo of our prototype, and this is set up here in Berks County. It's been operating for quite some time, and we have, I think, conclusively demonstrated the performance of it. We've gotten about, in the low 70% range overall performance across a year of data and also at the peak. So we're getting very good performance. And then However, that's not particularly revolutionary. You know, other parabolic dishes would have gotten that type of performance. I think what's special about what we're doing is the way that we've approached the manufacturing. So we've basically designed this from the ground up to be a fully productized and fully industrialized solution. It's not a scaled up lab solution. It's a solution that's designed to be volume manufactured at low cost. So we're doing things like casting various components. We are stamping the pedals like you would be stamping out a car door. And we're using very low cost materials, steel, aluminum, to produce this device. It's essentially all metal. So, you know, it's also highly recyclable. I think the driving down the cost is while capturing that superior performance is really the direction that we're going in here.
Nisha, before you go on, just a question. I mean, you know, all the aspects of sustainable aspects, it's great to hear that. Just for a sense of scale, I can't tell if that's a person standing next to it, but it appears to be. Is that right? Is there?
No, yeah. It's about a 4.5. This one's about a 4.5 meter diameter.
Okay. And then the height off the ground is like looks
about
like
10 maybe, feet. Yeah.
About 10 feet to the bottom. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's kind of. And then you said the dish is four and a half meters, which is roughly 12, 13, 14 feet, something like that. So to the top, it's something less than 25 feet.
Yeah. So it's not a small system. Uh-huh. It is of some scale. However, compared to other technologies like power tower or parabolic trough, it's very modular. It can go in on a mast. You can basically pile drive the mast into the ground, mount the dish on top. It can be installed very, very quickly relative to other technologies and on terrain that would otherwise have to be, you know, leveled or graded, prepared at high cost. We can sort of just put these in relatively cost effectively without having to invest a lot in leveling the terrain. So we see a lot of savings on the cost of installation and also on commissioning. Also in the unit cost of the device itself. In terms of operation, we've been able to operate this basically fully autonomously with extremely minimal interventions for long periods of time. So the maintenance and operational costs should be very low. And then at end of life, because it's all metal and can be easily recycled, there should be minimal impact to the environment at that point. Aluminum and steel can be infinitely recycled. Right. So that's another big advantage.
Yeah. Okay. Didn't mean to interrupt your flow.
No. So, this is another photo here. This is the receiver. So what happens is the dish tracks the sun. All the light gets focused into this cavity receiver. There's a coil, as you can see here, with a fluid circulating through it. And you can see the inlet and outlet pipes here. And then they sort of run through this leg of the receiver. You can see the pipes coming out of the end of that leg, but that runs through a storage tank and then a heat exchanger. So there's an oil. It's actually a mix of water and glycol that's in this particular example. But for higher temperatures, we'd be using an oil. So that just runs through the pipe. It's pumped around in a circuit. And then it goes through a heat exchanger where on the other side of the heat exchanger, that can be water or air. And we will be running through that heat exchanger and injecting the heat into the use case, whatever that is. So it's pretty simple. It runs, it's sort of like a boiler. It's like a solar boiler in a way. It's very much like the parabolic trough, just we think more efficient, more cost-effective. We have had outside experts look at this. And so far what I've been told is it's the best concentrated solar power solution that they've seen. We're just in the process of trying to get the execution of the productized version finished so that we can now market this.
So is that okay? Good.
Yeah. I think we have about five more minutes.
Yeah. Okay. So that's you kind of gone through your slides. Yeah. All right. So I have a couple of quick questions. It's kind of working backwards. What temperature is this oil or the glycol water solution?
Yeah.
What in the pipes that we're looking at, like what kind of what
so this would be suitable for a high temperature hot water kind of use case. We're looking at about 80°C, 80-90°C in these pipes. With higher temperature fluids, we could get up to 250, 300, even 350. In fact, the maximum would probably be about 390 with the fluids that we're looking at. So that's suitable for steam production. So we're looking at sort of high temperature hot water applications, which would be about 80°C, and then steam applications, which would be 250, 300°C.
And when you're saying C, you're talking centigrade.
Yeah, centigrade, sorry.
Okay, no, just, yeah, you know, we Americans, we didn't go there. Is it feasible for one dish?
Yeah, you could have a single dish, anything from one dish. Now, you know, because of all the balance of plant equipment that goes into an installation, the more dishes you have, there's probably a minimal scale that's like optimal from an economic point of view, which would be, you know, a few dishes, I would say, because you have to average that balance of plant equipment over the production. Mm-hmm. But you can definitely go as small as one dish.
One dish just for an idea would handle, like, what kind of building type would one dish suffice for heat?
Right. So we have two versions. We have a smaller dish, which has a 14 meter squared aperture that has about a 10 kilowatt peak. And then we have a larger dish that has a 42 meter squared aperture, and that has about a 29 kilowatt peak. It really depends. You could probably do like a couple of houses with a larger dish, I would think.
Okay.
Although I'm not sure offhand. Depends.
Let's talk a little bit about applicability.
You
and I before the program talked about it. So, you know, I think you said like I forget the type of facility you mentioned, a couple, like a warehouse or industrial application. So let's say middle-sized factory would need how many of these to?
So this is one of the just in terms of applicability. So the use cases are industrial process heat, water desalination purification, space heating and cooling, and then remote power generation. Those are like the main use cases. Now, where can this be used? So let's just talk about geography first, and then kind of the other criteria. So you need direct sunlight for concentrated solar power. So the best place in the United States would be the US Southwest, places like Southern California, Arizona, New Mexico, et cetera. There are other parts of the world where this concentrated solar power can work extremely well, notably North Africa, the Middle East, Israel, Spain, Southern Europe, South Africa, Australia, places like this, kind of around the 30th parallel, north and south, are generally good. So you need clear skies. Then you need an application with a temperature requirement in the sort of somewhere between 50°C and 350°C. And then you need enough space to host a field of these units. And that really is a function of how much energy you consume. But you, like any solar power solution, you do need space to host the technology. They can go on a rooftop, but you would need a good amount of space next to the plant.
So we've got a minute left. Real quickly, just as an example, how many of these would go on sort of are we talking about 10, 100, 1,000?
So we looked at one plant. We were looking at putting 80 units on a rooftop, and that would have basically covered all of their thermal energy needs and a portion of the electrical need.
Okay. All right, well, we're out of time.
Okay.
We need to close. I think you had a slide with contact information for the company?
I did.
Okay. So it's pronounced Naoise Irwin?
Naoise Irwin. contact@solarflux.co is our email address, and our website is www.solarflux.co. So feel free to reach out should there be interest in learning more.
Yeah, and the website has some good information. So Nisha, you know, I think we could have easily gone longer. There are a lot of other questions I had, but I think you did a good job of giving us a sense of this. I mean, I wanted you on the program because I think it's really exciting. And I have to say that the reason I heard about you was Berks County Community Foundation in their newsletter had mentioned that they've provided you some funding, which
that's true.
Says a lot about faith in what you're doing, and I'm really glad that there's that support in the community.
So, yes, we're very appreciative of the support of the Berks County Community Foundation and the Solar Energy Fund affiliated with them.
So I want to thank all our viewers, and see you next month. And I hope to, you know, I'm going to keep tabs on Solarflux and what you guys are up to. I think it's really great. I really applaud this. It sounds like really promising technology. And I will add that the idea of industrial process heat, that kind of application seems so good, because that's been a conversation we've had about industry in Reading. It's like, well, how are they going to produce the heat they need for manufacturing without solar power? And so and there's the goodbye sign. So
okay. Thank you so much. I appreciate your time and for having me on.
Thank you, and best of luck.
Okay.
Thanks.
Building Green on BCTV is supported by BARDA.